ओम शांति। वी फाइंड इन अव्यक्त मुरलीज दैट बाबा हैज गिवन सो मेनी टाइटल्स टू ब्राह्मण सिस्टर्स एंड ब्रदर्स एंड मेनी ऑफ दीज टाइटल्स नॉट ओनली इंडिकेट द हाइट ऑफ द सोल्स हु आर टेकिंग दिस स्पिरिचुअल नॉलेज but also imply the responsibility of those instruments. There is the other side of those titles. Suppose, for example, Baba says you are special souls. It's not only a matter of happiness, pleasure, that Baba gives us this title. It's not only a question of satisfaction to us that we are special souls. Of course, we get intoxicated when Baba says this. But it also implies that we have a special responsibility. There is the other side to it. If we are special souls, then there is something special expected of us. Rites always imply duties. That is the other side of the coin. So whenever you find Baba gives us a title, you just notice the other side of it, what it implies. Baba says, you are double light. You are lucky stars. Now who are lucky stars? Who make others lucky? Else I can't be a lucky star. I can be a lucky star if I do the duty of making others lucky. That is what makes my luck. Without that, if I do not do any good action, any action which brings merit to me, how can I be a lucky star? So if Baba says that I am a lucky star, it means that there is a special role assigned to me, namely that I have to make others also lucky by imparting them this knowledge, which gives a responsibility to me. So there's a great responsibility for us sisters and brothers. Not only this period of Sangam Yoga is a period of intoxication, really a wonderful period when we play a role with Shiv Baba. It's something very unique which we don't have throughout the whole Kalpa. Really something very intoxicating. We never thought, never even ever dreamt that we will have an occasion to play our role with the Supreme Being. No scripture mentions it. God created the world. How God created the world, it has been variously described in various scriptures. But nowhere is it mentioned in any scripture, whichever religion, that human souls also played a role with God of creating the world, a new world, side by side. They were also given this privilege and pleasure. So when we look at it from that point of view, then there is a great responsibility that devolves on us. And when we talk of avastha and vyavastha, that is our spiritual stage and our manner of management or organizing things, the first thing is that our mind should be organized. We are the creators. The creation will be as the creator is. As creators, because Baba has been saying very often, one of the titles he has been giving us is, you are master creators. So if we are master creators, we are to create something, and that creation will reflect the creator. The creation always reflects the creator. An artist paints something, he draws a beautiful image of something. Now that reflects his talent, his ability, what is going on in his mind. Which colors he likes and why. It is a mirror of his state of mind. So if we are master creators as we are, as Baba has given us this role, you are master Brahma, even Baba has been saying, then there is a great responsibility. If our own mind is in an ordered state, in the Gita there is a verse which says, Vyavasthatmika Buddhi. There are many kinds of buddhis which have been mentioned in Sanskrit. Intellect is of many kinds. Say about 12 or 13 have been mentioned, various kinds of intellects. One of the kind of intellects is Vyavasthatmika Buddhi. That your mind is always in an organized form. You are never in confusion. It's not that you are ever at any point of time uncertain about things. Things are very clear in your mind. The plan of action, the line of action, your goal, the way you will be doing things. Everything should be clear. Like an architect plans the building, then he asks the masons to lay brick by brick and build the building. First of all, he has a clear picture of what the building will look like when it finally comes into being. Likewise, we are going to create a world of which Baba has given the image. There will be love in that world, there will be no quarrel, no disharmony, there will be perfect unity, all will be happy, no suffering, nothing. Everyone will be the ruler of the sense organs. Baba has given this. The architect has given this plan. Now we are to lay the bricks according to that plan. If we don't have love among ourselves, how can we create a world in which there will be always love? If we are going to create a world in which there will be always harmony and no one will be the servant to one's sense organs, and if we have some part of it in our life as Brahmins, then how can we be the creators of that world? So the final goal, if it is very clear to us, and we know that we are master creators, then our all actions will be directed towards that goal. And this is the first thing of altering our state of mind. Whenever a situation presents itself before us and we are called upon to do an action, the very first test of our action should be whether it will lead to that goal. If it leads to that goal, it is all right. If it leads to a copper-aged world, silver-aged world, not to a perfect world, then that action is not worthy of Brahmins. It could be fit for Kshatriyas or some lower grade souls, not for us at least. Baba demands of us something highest. Therefore he gives us the highest titles, which no one has ever been given by anyone. So that is the first thing, altered state of mind. Unless and until our mind is very clear, let us not set to doing work. It's better to wait and then do the work, rather than to do the work in a haphazard way, in a disorganized way, without any clear picture in our mind. And in order that our mind may be altered, one of the most important things is that we should be in link with Baba. Moment to moment, we should be able to receive directions by a wireless sort of method, by some telepathic method, from Shiv Baba. And if our mind is not in tune with him, then I'm sure it is not completely organized. It's not completely ordered. If it is ordered, it will be calm, quiet, tranquil, peaceful, loving, pure, honest. All these qualities will be there. And then it will be in a fit state in which it will be able to be tuned to Shiv Baba. When it is tuned to Shiv Baba, then you have a higher intellect which is guiding you, besides your own. We may have our own talents. We will work with them. But there may be certain things which we may miss, which we may forget to do. And suddenly you will find a thing flashes on your mind. Automatically it comes. Without you are even applying your mind to it, without even making an effort to think about it. Suddenly it comes from somewhere. And from where? From Shiv Baba, if we are tuned to him. Very often we find we have missed certain things. We are just sitting and like a message it comes to us, our mind, oh, you should have done this. It will be a very good idea if you do this. We make plans, we have meetings, things and all that. But then there is another method to it. It is intuitive. It is from Shiv Baba's touchings. We get inspirations from him. This is the most golden. This is the highest, noblest. Because the fullest plan is with him. He is the actual creator. We are all his aids, his helping hands. We are just working as his instruments. So if our mind is in this state, then our work will be fine. If after that anything happens, I think it is not our responsibility. We are not to blame for it. So I think, suppose a student comes, he comes and we have to give him a 1 week course. Now before we begin talking to him, now we have got a practice over a period of time, how to teach a newcomer, what should be the first lesson, how to start it. It's all right. Now we have become experienced. But the first thing is to stabilize yourself in meditation before you begin to talk to him. Then certain thoughts will come to your mind. Because this individual soul who has been sent by Shiv Baba always thinks that he has come as has been sent by Shiv Baba. He has goaded him to this place. Even though he has read something in the newspaper about this institution, or you have given an invitation or a flyer or whatever, all the same he would not have come, because many others received the invitation, they didn't come. Many others read the newspaper, they didn't come. This man has come, of all the other people. It is because his time has come. And Baba has sent him to you. And now you have a great responsibility. It is a question of his life and death. If you do not give him knowledge in a proper way, his 21 lives are gone. You see. Not one death. So what a great responsibility is on us. If a doctor begins to inject someone without sterilizing the needle, what will happen? If the needle is rusty, or if it has not been properly put into the boiling water or has been, sterilized, then what will happen? So first of all, we have been rusty souls. Our rust is being removed. Not completely as yet we have become in that fit state. So the first thing is to sterilize ourselves. Baba, this soul has come. Baba, let the lock of Maya be opened. Baba, he may also receive your heritage. Let us first of think, Baba says, have good wishes toward that soul. And have compassion, have mercy. Think that he is your brother, come. Like the prodigal son, come. Invited by Baba. And then you begin to give this knowledge to him when you feel that you yourself are detached from the body. For example, we will tell him that we are souls, we are not bodies, bodies are the instruments, so on and so forth. But are we in that state? Are we living that truth? If we are living that truth, then when we look into his eyes, and then when our words come from our mouth, they will shoot the targets properly. And this man will, like you shoot a person here with 303 gun, he will certainly die, you see. So will happen with this man. If the arrows of knowledge, the arrows of truth shoot him at the proper point, then this man will have a new birth. He will die the old life he is leading. So that is the way, first of all, to get organized, to set our own mind in an ordered state. Then there are many other things which a teacher is supposed to do. Now, I have had some thoughts and I noted them down to share these with you. The first thing is that teacher should be himself or herself a student. Any teacher who thinks that he or she has learned or knows Baba's Murlis, the essence at least, so on and so forth, cannot be a good teacher. So the first thing is to be a regular student self and to think that it is a lifelong study. I am also yet to learn. The only thing is that I am the first among equals, that's all. Not to think that I am a teacher and this one is a student, but to think that we are all brothers and sisters. Of course, Baba has given me this role. So the most you can say is that I am the first among equals, that's all. So if I consider myself also as a student and then do this work, I will have humility. I will have the motive of service. I will not have any kind of bossism in my mind, things like that. And these are necessary to establish that world. Baba says that golden aged world is established by means of godly knowledge, yoga and purity. Without these, godly, the new world cannot be established. New world cannot be established by means of money, by means of worldly talents, by means of many PhD degrees obtained in various disciplines in academic field. No. This can be established by purity, by meditation power, yoga bal, gyan bal. Baba says the power of yoga, the power of knowledge, the power of purity. The world sovereignty can be established by these powers. So unless or until I am full of these powers, I am knowledgeful, I am pure, and I am meditating, I am a good quality yogi, I cannot establish Satyug. Satyug can be established by these powers. So the very first thing is that I equip myself with these powers. I am a soldier of the spiritual army, and these are the weapons of this army, which is to eliminate the devilish qualities from this world. And this is possible only when I consider that any occasion for me is an occasion for learning. Any chance to me to learn something is a welcome chance. Never do I feel tired. Never do I feel any shortage of time. Never do I feel anything boring if it is an occasion for me to learn. Learn, learn and learn. To study, to understand, to increase my, wealth, my treasure of knowledge and my yoga power. Because this is the means and the wherewithal wherewith I am to do the service. And the second is that the teacher should not only consider it himself or herself as a teacher, but also as a manager. One has to manage. A teacher has to be a manager. It is a small kind of establishment which he is running. So he has to consider from that point of view. It's not that one has to go to the school and just give a lecture and come back. But one has to see, and in modern system of education also, even in the secular studies, it's understood that environment, maintaining the environment, is very important education. In fact, much of our education is informal education. And it is through the environment, through imitation. It's only a very small part of education which we get at the feet of a teacher in a formal manner. Much of it comes from the environment. So the first thing the teacher has to do as a manager, as I said, he is an ex officio manager, you can say. He has a double role to play. And the first thing to manage is the environment. If in the center the vibrations are not strong, the first thing anyone comes is, should feel, oh, it's very peaceful. He should feel happy, as if he did not feel happy anywhere before. Before you started giving the course to him, the very first thing is the environment should attract him. The mottos you have, the pictures, the way you put the pictures, the way the pictures are painted, and neatness and cleanness, and the most of all, the vibrations, the spiritual vibrations, the smile on your face, and one should feel that one is welcome. It's very important that one should feel that one is wanted here, as if you were waiting for this person. One should get such kind of a treatment. The very first thing is the treatment. They say a satisfied customer is the best advertisement. And now if some student comes and feels at home, not only in a spiritual institution, Baba says it's a family institution. Not that one sees that this is a teacher I am talking to, but also it's a mother, it's a sister I am talking to. This kind of feeling should be there, so that the very first thing one gets is a kind of a welcome. Not in a formal way, but the feeling is this, that I am wanted here, I am invited here. Everyone feels happy that I come here. So I was saying that the teacher has first of all to maintain the proper environment. And from that point of view, and from many other points of view, a teacher is a manager. A teacher is also a leader, because there are students, and the teacher has to lead, to make plans for service, and to give roles to all, to make everyone's life fruitful, so that everyone has something to do, and someone has to give them the roles. Everyone should feel satisfaction that they also have a chance for service. So the teacher has to serve as a leader, and not only as a leader which only instructs or gives directions, but one who inspires. The first thing is that the personality, the behavior, the lifestyle should be inspiring. All should feel enthusiastic, zestful. Even if they miss one day coming to the class, they should feel that they have not met the teacher. What an inspiring personality this person has. What the loveful tones she talks into. Not only that, missed Baba Murli, suppose he does not like something from the Murli. The teacher's personality should also attract that person. The teacher, as they say, God created man in his own image. The teacher should work in Baba's image, should create that Baba's image. That's very important. And that is possible only when the teacher's own mind is well ordered. If the teacher's face reflects confusion, worry, tension, hurry, some other kind of thing, it's not Baba's image. It's not inspiring. One feels that she is in a hurry, let me go, I have come at a wrong time, you know. Things like that. And twice or thrice if it happens, then one thinks that perhaps one does not want me here. I don't know whether she was actually in a hurry or she always behaves like this, you see. Then you have to ask him, why don't you come? For a long time you have not come. What is the need of asking this if previously I had not reacted in a way so that this man felt that he is not wanted here, you see. This sort of thing. Then suppose in a class there are some teachers, Someone has written, Sir John Dewey, an educationist in America, he wrote many volumes, Problem Teacher, Problem Student, Problem Parent, like that, you see, and Problem Society. Now suppose there is a student who is a problem student. There can be some such students who are problem students. Now if the reaction of the teacher toward this student, because you are not treating only one student, suppose one student is a problem student. When you are dealing with that student, others are noticing. Don't think that you are dealing only with this person. Others are there in the class. How you deal this person, this ticklish question, this problem, has got some kind of a impact on them. Whether you are nice to them, you are humanitarian towards them, you treat harshly, or you smile to this person, you welcome, it is the fault of the other person, or you also are at the fault. Others are indirectly noticing this. So, even if a student is a problem student, the teacher should never comment on such a student, so that this person feels that he has been disgraced and defamed in the presence of everything, all other people. Let him not get hurt. Otherwise, he will, as I said, a dissatisfied customer would be the worst. As a satisfied customer, as I said, he would be the best advertisement. This one who has felt hurt, he would take revenge. He would go to so many people, he would say, what kind of spirituality? They don't know even how to talk, you see. They are not spiritual people. They talk always the same thing, soul, soul, supreme soul, meditate, so on and so forth. They will say like this. At least they should be satisfied with our personal behavior, humanitarian way of dealing with people, considering everyone as a dignified individual. So there should be never insinuations or some kind of hurting remarks. Ever. If we have to talk something to somebody, let us talk in a private way. Fix some appointment with him and talk to him in a loving way, in a dignified way. If this person does not want this knowledge, it is his choice. Why you ask him to run away from here? Because that way you will get the discredit. If he leaves on his own, it is his choice. He will be harming himself. Let us not be responsible for this. So publicly, let us not talk in negative terms to anybody, because anybody feels that he has a self-respect. That is how they take a self-respect. Our way of looking at self-respect may be different. But they think that I have a self-respect. If I come here and somebody does not respect me, there is no point in my coming here. Don't do that. And suppose someone is a problem child, problem student. Then if we want to say something, suppose there is an occasion to say, then we can say not pointedly to that person, but in general terms. This is what we saw Baba used to do. A child has come and there is report about him from the center that he is a great problem. Baba, he is a great problem. You see, so on and so forth. The teacher is here, or she talks to Baba and says that this is the difficulty. Now, Baba would not say this to that person directly, but in a general way, so that if this man is open to understanding, then from the general also he could understand that this thing what I am doing is wrong, I should not do. Otherwise, if you talk to him personally, even then also he may not understand it. So the best thing to do in a dignified way is to talk of a thing in a general way. Suppose someone is intolerant, is a short-tempered person, easily becomes angry, irritable. Now you can give a talk or two on irritability, on anger, on how we should have patience, how we should bear with things. And maybe that one or two points appeal to this person, and he further on changes his behavior. That would be the best way, the first way, first step which we should take. Then when I said that the teacher is also a leader, and a teacher can be a leader only when the teacher understands the students. A creator can create when he understands the stuff he is to handle, the mechanism, the instruments given to him for this. So one has to understand the individuality of a person, his talents, his abilities, his difficulties, his own personal problems. He has to understand. Then only proper roles can be assigned. And sometimes it so happens we depend upon the information given to us by others. Never take it as final, unless and until you yourself have known what sort of this person is. And even then, Baba says we should keep foremost the good points, the positive qualities of the person. Because Baba says, make the best even out of the worst. Waste ko bhi best banao. Baba says, make best even from the waste. Let us suppose that this person has got many bad qualities, many negative qualities. But at least this one must have some good qualities. You make use of those good qualities for the creation of the new world. And this person will in the process be himself transformed. That is the way. Don't look upon the negative side. Oh, he can't do anything at all. He is a lazy person. He takes responsibilities, doesn't do anything at all. He will fail you in this job. In the last moment, he will say he can't do it. Then what will you do? You keep another man to fill the gap if that happens. All right, if you know this can happen. But give that responsibility. Why are you depriving this person? It is a kind of an exploitation. It is a kind of a cruelty you are doing to this person. Because when this person also does the service, he also is able to make his fortune. And if you are depriving him of this opportunity, simply because one has this or the other weakness, so you are doing something wrong. Like a mother who would like that every child should find some standing, some foothold on the in his life. You should also try your best. If a child does not know how to speak, she goes and consults the speech experts and tells what is wrong with the tongue of my child. Please do something so that he can speak. I want to hear one sentence from her. He does not give up. She does not give up and say he can't speak at all. It is a defect from his very birth. She is worried. Even so, if a person can't do anything, you should feel what you are called upon to do rather than give it up. It is your own weakness if you give it up. You can't, it means stand the challenge. It is a challenge to your talent. Answer this rather than give it. Why you become hopeless about this person? When Baba has sent this person and Baba says everyone is a special person, the only thing is you have not been able to notice the speciality in this person. Try to find out what speciality this person has. Inspire him on that. And when that person gets intoxicated and inspired, can do great. Much he can do. They say every saint has been a sinner. And every sinner has a future. Every sinner saint has a past. Same maybe with this person. He may be a bad person, but he might have once upon a time. Baba says you are all deities, gods and goddesses, but we are not. Once upon a time we were. And Baba sees this. And then he tells us, all right, now you can become again. If Baba sees our present state, we are worth for nothing, worth not even for a penny. But Baba says that you can do this, you can do that, because once upon a time you were great. So why don't you see a kind of a spark of a divinity in this person? That is what you should see. That is the third eye. Otherwise you are keeping your own third eye closed and asking this man to run away from here. It's a wrong thing. Another thing is that the teacher should have respect for seniors. If the teacher does not have respect for those who are senior to her, then she can't expect the students also to honor her. A stage will reach when they will also begin to comment on her adversely. Then she can't say that ye muh phate hain, they speak whatever they like, they don't know how to speak with grace, you know, they don't have manners and etiquette. You can't blame, because you yourself have been doing this. And he will also now follow you. So the best thing is to always be dignified. Don't give a chance to others to imitate you, the wrong things in you. You have therefore first of all to set an example unto others. And not to talk ill of the students in the presence of other students. If you begin to do this, then you are giving a bad habit to the students. Then one student will talk to the other students about this student. Or they will talk to you that this student is not good. You are opening the gates of negativity. The best thing is that you don't comment. Everyone has got some bad thing. Show me a person who does not have negative points. So what if this man has? Why you notice this? Are you not able to notice any good points in this student? If you are able to notice something good, why don't you talk about that? And very often our senior sisters used to hold a class. They would give a piece of paper to one and asked to write the good qualities of the person sitting, then pass it on. Then all would add what they see about the other persons. Or they would give a piece of paper to everyone to give the good qualities of others. This would give them the habit of seeing the good quality of all, rather than give them the practice of noticing the bad points and all. There are so many. perhaps infinite, if you just look at them. But Baba, by means of meditation, by means of His grace, His kindness, His shelter, His protection, His compassion, His help, He removes. Otherwise, if you just want to make a list of it, it would be a very, I mean, bigger than perhaps the British Encyclopedia. A very long list. Now, another thing is, when a center is open, someone is running a center. Now, one may not have all the means of service. When one first begins to do a service, there is no typewriter, not even a typist, not a person to have some help in another way. So, the teacher has not to get frustrated. It's a very great thing you are doing, very big work you are doing, creating a new world. It's more enormous a task than the task of a single government, or even of a superpower. The work which you are doing has got great implications, great significance. But the means which you have been given are the crudest, the least. The people, we don't have trained, civil servants. We don't have those who have done management courses. We don't have people who have done secretarial courses. We don't have people who are administrators by training. We don't have people who know the public relation work. They don't have. Or anyone who has been a very trained kind of editor or journalist or advertisement manager. Gradually we are getting. But in any country, when you start a service, you don't have all these people to help you. But when you think that Baba is with you, that is the greatest asset which no one has. Baba is with you, and He created us. We have become His instruments. So now when you are the creator, you have also to create like He created you, like someone created you. So instead of thinking that we don't have this, we don't have that, what is it, our people don't help us, don't give us this. Instead of that, if we think the best architect, master is one who with the least instruments, the crudest instruments, is able to do the highest. That is the sign of a great artist, a great scientist. The great scientists had no big laboratories as we have now. They didn't have those instruments which we find today. They were not given so many heavy grants from their government as people get now. But they made some tremendous inventions, new concepts, which were revolutionary. They just made indigenous and improvised instruments with some small things, they gathered together certain parts. You just see first telescope, how it was made, first car, how it was made, first kind of aeroplane or even bicycle, what kind of it was, the first model. So that sort of thing, we should have that spirit. That even though we are, now take the case of Sakar Baba, how many hands he had? When I came to Yajna and I was here, there were only five brothers. Only five dedicated brothers, and the whole institution was being run. And now how many they have multiplied, and everyone wants to be dedicated. And everyone is dedicated. Even if one has not given up jobs and other things and is not sitting in Pandabhavan Madhuban, yet everyone is doing with dedication. Because they are doing for the love of Baba, for the love of this work. Because it is something great they would be doing. They feel the satisfaction, the fulfillment, that is why they do. Even without anybody asking, they would say, is there anything we can do? It is, the demand comes from them, rather than from your asking. So the only thing is, if we are in an ordered state of mind, you will find people come forward to help you. They will say, oh, you don't have a typewriter. It's very great work you are doing. Can I help you with a typewriter? Can I do some typing work for you? I have some spare time. Can I do the secretarial work for you? People come forward. So, one of the things is, don't think that for such a great work, I have no hands, no money, no instruments, nothing. Baba says, from beggar to prince. Think that it is your privilege to be beggar in this life. And from beggar is great, I have nothing. The only thing I have is Baba. The more you have many things, your mind will be directed towards those things. And if you are Girdhar Gopal, dusra na koi, you have nothing but only Girdhar Gopal. You remember nothing and only Shiv Baba. When I first went to America with a group, with Ramesh Bhai, Rosie Ben and others, Shilindra, then all had some relatives and friends in New York. They would come and ask them to accompany them to visit Statue of Liberty, this and every other thing. No one knowing me. And I would like to say, Mere to Girdhar Gopal, dusar na koi. Only Shiv Baba is mine. I have no friend, no relative, nothing in this world. He is my everything. And I was happy with it. Not that I have some worldly things, but I have only one thing, which is the greatest. That is my only asset. So if, and originally when I came here, Baba used to write letters and in the end he would write Om Baba. Om Baba, he would sign. And in the end he would write, beggar to prince. I am beggar in this life. And he lived like a beggar. You have not seen his room, his gaddi. His gaddi was his office. There he used to sleep, there he used to sit, there he used to write letters. This cottage was made only later, this hut. That room, which has now been renovated and given facelift, much of it has changed. If you had seen the original room, it was nothing. It was like the room of a beggar, how he lived. So, and what kind of work he did, what great world he is creating, and that is great. Because with the least possible expectations, the least demands, the least kind of help, if you do great things, then you are really great. This is what we are supposed to do. Let one man do the work of 10, at least. Here, everyone doing many roles, one role. Baba used to say, don't say, for this I require this person, for this work I require another person, for this work I require another person. Then what are you? You are just to get these from him and do nothing. On the other hand, you should say, I can make the meals, I can also type, I can also post the letters, and I can give the class, I can do this, I can do that. Baba says one person should be able to do work for so many persons. Then only you can be lucky stars. Otherwise, don't be puffed up when Baba says lucky stars. Think that you will be lucky stars when you do the work of 10 people. Then only you will have luck of 1 multiplied by 10 or raised to the power 10. And not only has one person to work for 10, but one person to do work in the minimum time, the least time. Because time is precious. The golden age has to come. People are asking us. You have been saying golden age will come. You have a picture of Krishna, Krishna, I am coming, coming. When is Krishna coming? He is saying, I am coming. You see, you don't give the time and the schedule and only say he is coming, keeping us expecting and waiting. You see, you tell us. And the reason is that we are working very slow. Very slow. Therefore, Baba says, become angels. He does not ask us to become angels only because that is our final stage, but also to work like angels. Angels work fastly. I told you that there is the other side of these titles. We sometimes go to the drama stage with the wings with us and we say angels have come. Not that kind of angels, but real angels who work very quickly, you see. Of course, when we do the drama, we have to show that. Don't take it that way. We have to show it. And as I said, one of the important things of the teacher is not only that every student understands every point of knowledge, and not only that everyone understands the point of every point of knowledge, but everyone understands the worth of every point of knowledge. What a tremendous treasure it is. What is the value of every point? Just not to understand that this world drama is 5,000 years. But if it were more or less, what would happen? To understand that this is the beauty of it. There could be nothing but this. And this is the most beautiful point. To understand it in such a way that he thinks that this is something precious he has got. Every point of knowledge. When we used to read physics, we know that, what was his name? Perhaps Archimedes. When he was in a pool of water, in some lake or some pool of water. Pardon? Archimedes. And he just thought of that, density and that weight. How the water replaces the equal weight of the person and how we swim and when a person gets drowned. And he said, Eureka, Eureka, perhaps this is what he said. And without dressing himself, naked he ran towards the palace in order to tell the king that he has discovered some very beautiful principle. He was so much fascinated with the idea that he forgot to wipe himself dry and to dress himself. People thought he is a crazy man. You see, he is running naked into the market. What happened to him? He was so much fascinated with that idea. I don't mean that you should also run like that. Perhaps the knowledge will receive the greater publicity when thousands of people run like that. no times, the London Times or New York Times may not print any news, but this will be printed, I suppose. With the photo also. But what I meant to say was that the teacher has the responsibility that it should fire with the zeal, fire with the zest. And that is possible only when everyone gets a missionary spirit. Or something so great, so wonderful, so precious. They should feel the inner urge, some kind of compulsive urge in their mind to tell it to others. No one can stop them because there is something urgent which is to be told to everyone. So that kind of job has to be done by the teacher, not in a thanda meetha way, not in that kind of way that the student is just able to understand. Understanding is a very, not a proper, a fit term to say that the teacher should give the understanding of this. But to fire with their zeal, to explain its value, its worth, and to such an extent that this person thinks that it is a question of life and death, this message must go. It must reach thousands of people. So that in one of the Murlis, Baba say, at least you should bring 1% daily to knowledge, to class. That is possible only when we are fired with this zeal. And then again, when we have to do anything, any kind of job has to be organized. Exhibition has to be organized, retreat is organized, conference is organized. Let there be clear instructions for everyone. Clear instructions, no confusion. Otherwise it causes disturbances and dislocations, disorganized things. And this causes a downward state of our being. If everything is fixed up, everyone knows clearly what everyone is expected to do, things go smoothly. As far as possible, let us do that way, so that there are no tensions. And everyone's face is calm and peaceful. Everyone feels that things here are in a very well-ordered and organized way. And then, whatever we do, one of the important tests of it is, it should be done with dedication. Fullest dedication. Not that we want to glorify ourselves or certain persons, or we have some personal self aims. Our class, our students, our divine family would think that we did it in a nice way. Not with these kinds of expectations. Our seniors would come to know that we can organize things well. The aim should be to glorify Baba, and we should do it with great dedication for the love of it and for the benefit of mankind, for the greater good of mankind. Our motive should be this. Other motives will not be as high as this. Dedication, dedication and dedication. People in the world do it with a motive of promotion. They think if we do good things, we will be promoted. Politicians think they would get promotion. They would get promotion. They would get, say, they may get presidency. They may become secretary of state. They may become prime minister of a country. And others working in the office, they think they will get a higher job by at some other place. Their motive ultimately to do things nicely in a well organized way and greater things is to get promotion. While our thing is to dedicate. Everything is for Baba. And whatever a teacher does, not as a boss. Others should not have the feeling. On the other hand, let the teacher initiate. Let it start. Participate in works. So that others get the feeling that we are doing a teamwork, of which teacher is also a part. The sense of participation should be there. And no kind of a bossism, but inspiration. And as I said, the first among equals. Others should think, of course, teacher has to be given respect. The teacher has a proper place. Now, another thing is that the teacher should organize things in such a way that all consider this kind of assignment which they have been given, or the whole plan, the whole scheme, the whole project, as for the enhancement of their own luck. They should not consider it as a mere work or a mere assignment, but something which is for the building up their luck, by doing which they would become more fortunate. They should look upon those assignments and the pieces of service which they have been given to do
they have been called upon to do, to consider it as a source of luck and as a pleasure. They should not feel this work as drudgery, something which makes them tired, makes them fatigued, which exerts their energy, taxes their energy, but something which is a pleasure, which is their very food, which is their very life, which they love to do, which gives them fulfillment, without which they can't remain. This kind of feeling should be there towards godly service. The leadership quality of the teacher should be such that it can bring this spirit in the work. Therefore, it is why some people say that work is worship. Not only that, it is to be done with a sense of dedication, with some kind of seriousness, but to feel it as a game, as a player, something enjoyable. Then there are many other things. Since the teacher is the leader, the teacher is the manager, the teacher it is who organizes things chiefly with the help of others, all playing, working as a team, many things have to be kept in mind. Sometimes it so happens that a person is in good cheer, in good mood. You ask this person to do this, that or the other thing, and one does it voluntarily, willingly, with joy. Now, it happens that this person is not in a happy mood because of some personal problems. Maybe that there is some job difficulty, there is something in the office, there is something in the family. Now, the stage of mind of this person is not as high as it was, say, a number of days ago. The teacher has to understand the difficulties of the individual. It should not say, what happened to you? You used to do a lot of work. Is it that you are now under the attack of Maya? You see, already this fellow may have been under the attack of Maya, but to say that he is under the attack of Maya is to add something, to put salt on the wound. It's like that. Instead of helping this person in this occasion, trying this person to out of this difficulty when he requires our help, to add some more burden to it is not service. It is disservice to this man. So this service should not call the plan for service, this new project which we are undertaking, should not be an occasion to do disservice to an individual. If someone says, sister, I am sorry, I would have had the love to do it, but because of certain circumstances, I am afraid I won't be able to give time. Don't comment like that. Try to understand the difficulties of this person. This person may have some real difficulties. Try to help, as this person has been helping us. This sort of attitude. And secondly, many things have to be kept in mind. Now people are doing service. We have to take care of their... who should be responsible if they feel hungry? We have to arrange for their meals. Something they should have to eat. So if the teacher says, what if you have not eaten one day? We have been working for years and we did not have proper meals. So you want to impose your experiences upon this person. That is not the way. What is required is that the teacher has also to play the role of a mother, as I said. To be loving, to be considerate, to look after them well. Not that these are only the instruments and they are meant only to do some kind of a work for us. They are not the work force given to us, a kind of a peace army which has been given to us to work with. All right, dig the earth here and they have started digging. Go back home and they go back home. Not things like that. But we have to treat them as someone whose responsibility Baba has given us to look after them well. Baba says the teacher is the world mother. Baba is the world mother and Baba is also a teacher. We have to follow Baba in this respect also. So that kind of thing, one has to be a tender-minded person and to look after others well, their needs. One has to care for them. And then certain things which may later on become problems. One sister and brother are working together for a project. They have a role to play. They are assigned some work and they work together. They work together all through the night, sitting together. Now what happens? Or they go together to various places for a long number of period, they have been allowed to go like that. Now Baba says we have all not been able to conquer Maya completely as yet. The fight is on. Maybe that a past sanskara comes up and something wrong happens. The teacher has also to see that she is allowing one or two persons to work together. Work has to be done, say, late hours. You are allowing two of them to sit together. Maybe today they are all right, tomorrow they are all right, but ultimately some intimacy may develop. And this may develop to some such a stage, then it may be wrong for them. It may, instead of bringing their progress, spiritual progress, bring their retrogress. So it's better to be aware of all these things, Baba's directions, what has to be done. They may be the best person in the class, the best brother and the best sister. But Baba says, let them not work together alone throughout the night or late night when all others are not there. Once a while, if it is some very urgent kind of work, it's different. But let us not make it a practice, a routine. Because what happens is, second time, if another brother or sister who are not of that kind of stage, that they also be allowed to work together late in the night in loneliness, then if you ask them not to do it, they will say, why you permitted the other person? So you are setting a wrong example, because you then can't prevent another person. And if you say that your stage of mind is not like theirs, so you are commenting upon them and they may feel hurt, they may not like this. So the best thing is to keep the maryadas, the spiritual principles which Baba has enunciated for us. The principles for work, a kind of a manual of work we are given, written or verbal. And we are to follow this. If we don't follow this, then even though we are doing some service, maybe that after some time some disservice will also crop up from this. It's not good. And another thing is, if some students take some initiatives, make some new plans, and give some new ideas, some new projects for service, the teacher is called upon to encourage, to give the wherewithal, the means wherewith this person can put this initiative into practice. Let not the jealousy of the teacher, that this person was my student and he wants to open a center, or he wants to do a work which is perhaps more important, more, it can be appreciated more than my role. If this kind of a sanskara or a thought in the teacher's mind come, it is very harmful. The teacher, like a mother, like a leader, like someone who wishes good, who wishes well for all, and has to see the progress of all the students, like a mother would be happy to see all the children progressing, shouldn't put any obstacles or discourage and say, oh no, it is not a good idea, not a good service. And the reason may be the jealousy, or the lack of foresight, or the lack of understanding of the project itself. On the other hand, it should give some kind of a thought, have others' advice, sometimes even write to the seniors and get their advice if he or she is not in favor of it, and try to encourage as far as possible, provided there is some potentiality in that service. Of course, if there is no such, it does not mean that we should in any case, in every case, encourage. But in order that this person may be able to progress, the maximum effort should be to encourage, to let the initiative work, and to give the help of hands, of money, self-cooperation, guidance, and everything, so that this can be done. And then there may be certain situations which may cause tension. This is the worst. If a teacher is affected by tension, then she loses her image, her impression is lost. Whatever teaching she may give, they won't, be very effective for bringing improvement in the students. The very first thing is to become peaceful, to remain peaceful. And this is what was mentioned again and again in Baba's Murli some days ago, that the very first thing which is expected of a Brahmin sister and brother, and much more from a teacher, is that she is always a peaceful. And when I say she, I also mean he, if he is a teacher. So attention is all right, but no tension. And then a kind of a spiritual sustenance, to give the students not only the knowledge, not only to give them some work, to assign them some role, but sustenance. They spiritually feel that it is their home, that they are always welcome, that like one feels at home. They say there is difference between house and home. Home is where you feel at home. So this kind of feeling they should have. And if they are passing through some kind of a spiritual turmoil, there is some kind of conflict in their mind, to listen to them, to sit with them, to sort it out, to help in that difficulty, and to give that kind of sustenance so that one feels that there is one spiritual sister, senior sister, or like a spiritual mother, to whom one could go and tell the problem and get some guidance and solution. In extreme cases, there may be some rare cases in which a student does not like the teacher. He is against the teacher, bitterly against the teacher. Maybe it is some past karma, or maybe something has happened now. Whatever it may be, he has got a repulsion towards the teacher, and may talk ill about the teacher to other students, and may even mention it to seniors, that you transfer this teacher from here, service will not grow if the teacher is here, so on and so forth. This problem may arise. It does arise at places. And this is a fire test for the teacher. It's very difficult. You give love to someone, you give 1 week course, you spend time, you spend energy, you have good wishes towards this person. You don't know what wrong you have done to this person, why this person talks like this. With all the best intentions, you want to offer the best of your services to this person. Despite all that, for no reason known to you, this person talks ill of you constantly and goes on writing letters to Madhuban. Transfer this teacher from here. The service is not progressing. The spiritual stage of this teacher is not good. He can't do any service, so on and so forth. Now, this is a great test. Pass this with a smile. Not with any bitterness toward this student. I can assure you that after some time, the situation will change. It will certainly change. Think that you are under a test, and it is for your own improvement. And if you are able to pass this test, you will become very great, really. Under such situation, if one passes with a smile, with happiness in the mind, with a peaceful nature, and does not react negatively to this person, this will be the person who will do the maximum advertisement for you later, I tell you. Baba says, one who just defames a person, it is that person later on who makes the best advertisement for this person. But I mean, when I say that you should react not negatively towards this person, not with the thought that he will become your best advertisement, Jagdish Bhai said, someday. Don't note it down in your notebook. But the idea in your mind should be, it's what Baba's teachings are. Now, because of this negativity, it is his habit or whatever, let me have the good wishes of this person. And Baba, open the lock of this person. I may only remember Baba, look at him with love, with sweetness. And I can assure you, after some time, the situation will change. But it will take some time. Don't be, disturbed by this. Because when you are disturbed, the other students are looking at you. And later on, you can't tell them that even if someone does not respect you or talks ill of you, you should remain calm and quiet. If ever this point comes in the Murli and you try to elaborate this point, they would put their heads down, not look into your eyes, because they think it's not proper at this time to do this. It is because they saw it with their own eyes what happened to you. It's not good. This sort of thing. Now, this is in short, in brief, what I wanted to say. Now, if there are some questions. She can't what?
So I started giving her the course, and then I developed some repulsion for her. And I decided, and my stage was a little bit, so I decided I don't want to see her anymore.
Mm.
And I said that another sister should continue with her. And the other sister hearing from me how her face was, just didn't want to touch her either. So we eventually said, okay, we will call you. But I, looking back, I feel it was no right somehow. So I don't know what the students are thinking. When they come to class and they keep following, but all they want is somebody that listens to their problem, and they hardly take any care.
Pardon? You have not been able to listen to the question? All right, please speak it. 1 second.
I would invite Sister Sudesh and Sister Meera also.
Make an announcement.
She wants to make an announcement.
That is very, very important. I'm waiting for that.
Something about Baba's pranam?
Yeah. So
therefore I will be leaving this afternoon. I had previously changed my pranam. Earlier I was to leave on 16th, but then it was changed to 22nd. But today I am leaving for Ahmedabad, from there to Bangalore for some urgent work. So it is perhaps, that is why my name is not included. Pardon? No, Dadiji made this pranam, you have to go. That's it. So, will you repeat the question? Sister Sudesh and Meera, would you please come here? Yeah, kuch questions bhi answer karenge na.
I had a student in New York and she was very difficult. Coming to me only with her personal problems mostly, but hardly taking any gyan. I developed a sort of anti-something or the other for her and asked another sister to take her over, which eventually she didn't do. And now I feel pretty bad that I just told her, all right, we will call you. What to do in such a case? When somebody comes to you and obviously they definitely need help and she definitely had a quite good intellect and would have taken care of, but there was too much of problems, of suicidal thoughts in her mind that there was no way that she would really be able to appreciate.
When she was putting this question, she was looking into the eyes of Sister Sudesh. So I pass it on to her. You notice that, no?
Baba has given us the understanding of creating hope in the hopeless case. Our good wishes are with them. At that time, certainly we do not, what I feel, that giving, no need to give too much knowledge if the soul itself is in that state of mind of committing suicide and that they won't understand the philosophy. But then love is, of course, very powerful force to support them. If you try to explain at that time that anyway, if you are committing suicide, you are carrying your karma with you, then you will suffer again. So that this is not the time to give them knowledge. But then, because they have come with some hope to get support. So, just with that great love, and with that feeling that if they have come in Baba's home, Baba is protector. Baba is the one who can support and give strength. So keeping Baba at that time in the mind, not that, okay, I want to give support, because otherwise I would be also influenced by the emotion of that person. So in that way, we are not able to give strength, because then there's fear. If I give some advice, if I am giving some advice and she does something wrong, then that feeling may tie us in bondage or create disturbance in the self. So support is what I feel, that with love, taking away their tension, that right amaze, of course you have been going through these difficulties, we understand, just sharing. We share their difficulty, but at the same time giving hope. Not indefinitely, but then if it is that once we win confidence, then we are able to give them knowledge. So first, not knowledge, first winning the confidence, love, that yes, we understand their difficulties. And then we are able to give the depth of knowledge. And that is because knowledge makes them powerful. Our love won't make them powerful. Love is just only to make them stand. So just like, kind of. But power is just, they have knowledge and yoga. So first step love, and then second step winning faith, and then it is encouraging. When? No, but if they are really, if they are very, very tense and they are not able to, then we don't have to put our energy too much in them. This is also understanding that is it worth that I need to give too much energy and time in that person. For example, if it is at that time, it's some mental disturbance. And in that state of mind, if you are trying to support them, you won't be able to. Just good wishes would be there, and better not to involve yourself. So that is the...
Yes, Sister Jaya.
Would you suggest again to
Dr.
Osakati or whatever, and say
that
you would be willing to see
him
again in the future?
Yeah, we will. It's generally it is they have been before also to doctors or psychiatrists that, but then relatives, we just say that okay, giving hints to their relatives that they should take care of this case. Whatever situation.